Welcome to The Way of the Master. In this program, we're going to look at something that very few people even think about, unless you happen to see a grisly murder scene with satanic symbols at the scene of the crime. We're talking about Satanism and its dark effect and influence upon a generation. Stay with us, because we're not only going to look at the obvious and blatant work of humanity's greatest enemy, but also uncover some of the most subtle of satanic deceptions. Seek and save the lost the way Jesus did. There's only a certain amount of time left. So use the law, use your testimony to reach out to the lost. There's nothing more important than your eternal salvation. We recently went to a heavy metal music festival and asked the people if they thought the music had any satanic influence.
But there's this whole satanic influence it's believed to be behind rock and roll music. Do you think that's true?
Hell no.
You don't?
And if you let music guide you in life the way people do and blame it, use it as an excuse, that's f***ing stupid as can be.
Do you think Satan has any influence over rock music?
No, I don't believe that.
Really?
No.
That's right here. You gotta be saved in order to go to heaven. We will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of Christianity.
You know, think that, you know, Satanism, you know, it's not like that. It's just music. It's rock and roll. That's all it is.
So the rest of it's just kind of a show.
Oh, yeah.
Frank Zappa declared, "I'm the devil's advocate. We have our own worshipers who are called groupies. Girls will give their bodies to musicians as you would give a sacrifice to a god.
You can have my soul."
Frank Zappa not only promoted Satanism, but acknowledged the subversive power of music.
Satan was one of the greatest musicians alive, right? Wasn't he? And then he turned evil, but I don't think this is really recommending evil. I think kids' outlooks on music is described more or less like what's cool and what's not, you know?
Do you think Satan has any influence on rock music?
No. No.
I wouldn't say it's satanic. No, it's not satanic. It's cool, you know, people listen to what they want to listen to.
They take it quite seriously. I look into the faces of our fans, and I see that they've been touched by the Dark Carnival the same way that I've been.
They're playing my tapes in your own car, in the tape deck, and I'm influencing your children.
Do you think he has any influence over rock music?
No.
Not at all?
Not at all.
There's no message in rock music that has anything to do with the devil or Satan or anything like that.
Tony Araya of Slayer, who influenced millions of people, stated, quote, "Our fans will go out and do whatever you ask." In their song Altar of Sacrifice, they write about sacrificing a young lady, quote, "Waiting the hour, destined to die, here on the table of hell, high priest awaiting, dagger in hand, spilling the pure virgin's blood, Satan's daughter, enter the realm." After two Slayer fans brutally murdered a 15-year-old girl, one of them admitted, "I'm embarrassed that I allowed Slayer's music to influence me." Yet another Slayer fan wrote into Spin magazine declaring, quote, "I hate your God, Jesus Christ. Satan is my Lord. I sacrifice animals for him. My God is Slayer. It is the words of their music I believe in."
There seems to be a lot of implications that heavy metal and Aussie music contains a lot of demonic or satanic undertones. What do you think about that?
No, I don't think so.
Aleister Crowley, who died in 1947, is known as the father of modern Satanism. Here's Ozzy Osbourne singing a tribute to this satanic high priest. In his publication, The Book of the Law, Crowley sums up the essence of Satanism. It is, do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. In other words, do what you want.
Geezer Butler of Black Sabbath, one of rock's most popular bands from the late 60s to the turn of the century, admitted, there was a weekly magazine called Man, Myth, and Magic that I started reading, which was all about Satan. That and books by Aleister Crowley. Black Sabbath's reunion album liner notes state, quote, Black Sabbath was launched in the U.S. with a party in San Francisco with the head of the Church of Satan, Anton LaVey, presiding over proceedings. All of a sudden, Sabbath were Satan's right-hand men. Black Sabbath became one of hundreds of bands recruiting millions of young people to Satan, reported even to go as far to give altar calls to receive Satan as Lord.
Jack, it's good to have you with us. Appreciate you coming and talking about the Church of Satan. Could you give us some background on the church?
Certainly. The Church of Satan was founded in 1966 by Anton Zander LaVey, who was kind of an interesting San Francisco character. He had an interest in the occult. He had been an organ player for different carnivals and circuses around the country. And he started a group called the Magic Circle, which was a group of people that were kind of interested in the occult and just had similar philosophical interests. And eventually in 1969, he wrote the Satanic Bible, and it's been continuously in print since then. And
how big is the Satanic Bible?
It's very short.
It is?
Yeah, you can read it. You can sit down and read it in an evening.
So what would be the message, if you could summarize the message of the Satanic Bible? What do you think it says?
Enjoy life in the here and now.
Well, that's nothing new.
I mean, it's certainly... And it's building that out. And it's building that philosophy out of living in the here and now and living kind of as animals would live, obviously more sophisticated, but living, taking the carnal very seriously.
So what would annoy the average Satanist about the average Christian? Now's your chance.
I think Satanists are generally annoyed by almost everyone. we're a very misanthropic bunch. We have very small groups of friends that don't annoy us. Obviously a Christian who preached to us, we would find that, you know, annoying. Because we more or less just want to be left alone and go about our business and follow our own interests. Hmm. You know, a lot of us are readers and we just kind of like to do do our own thing.
Do your own thing.
Yeah.
Jack, what are the benefits to being a member of the Church of Satan?
Well, essentially, there are none. As far as if you want to be a member, it's almost it's a conscious act of kind of throwing your lot in with the devil, you know, taking up that archetype and saying, this is who I am.
Satan represents the powers of force in nature, and we feel that a cleansing of the idiot ideology of the pallid, incompetent Christ is in order. And so this is something that the Church of Satan is conducting on many different avenues. We're doing this through the use of what we have called aesthetic terrorism. This involves the creative use of art, music, writing, effectively what we call propaganda, the dissemination of information to influence what we call iron youth.
I understand Marilyn Manson joined the church. Mm-hmm. How did that affect it?
Marilyn Manson is a very creative public figure. But he's also attracted a lot of young kids to the church, and a lot of young kids who are not necessarily Satanists. So, while we respect him and the things that he does... some of the people that he attracts are not necessarily Satanists, and we find we kind of have to just go through them. And
when you say they're not Satanists, does that mean they're not doubting enough? They come in with faith?
Yes, they're not doubting enough. No, they're more interested in shocking their parents. Yeah. You know, they want to put on the makeup like he does. You know, he has some really cool makeup, and so they copy it. And you know, he has some interesting reasons why he does certain things, whereas they are kind of just doing it to. They're followers, and we don't want followers in the Church of Satan, we want leaders.
Does Marilyn Manson have an influence on you, personally?
Kind of, sort of.
What do you think about him when he tears up a Bible and kind of mocks God in his stuff?
I'm all for it. I'm a Satanist myself.
If anything, they teach you to open your mind a little.
You really think Marilyn Manson's makeup is cool? Would you wear it?
I think when I was younger, I might have.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah. I mean,
but you've matured.
You know, he has a creative look, and you know, it's kind of his own thing. Uh-huh. I mean, he's cobbled together a lot of different interesting images and worked with them. So.
My fellow Americans, we will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of Christianity. And we will no longer be oppressed by the fascism of beauty. Because I see you all sitting out there trying your hardest not to be ugly, trying your hardest not to fit in, trying your hardest to earn your way into heaven. But let me ask you, do you want to be in a place that's filled with a bunch of...
On a certain level, Satan is something that we tap in, is a part of ourselves that we tap into. Hmm. So, you know, when we say hail Satan, to a certain extent, I'm saying hail me. Hmm. So it is...
You're on the throne.
Yeah.
So it's the self-church.
Certainly.
But
certainly.
That would not hold the shock value that the Church of Satan holds.
Well, certainly. And, you know, the people who want to follow, want to be accepted, who seek acceptance of other people, you know, who just want to be the good guy, are never going to join the Church of Satan. We want people who are not interested in what other people think. So by saying that you're a Satanist, you've already crossed out so much of the population.
All religions are coming around to Satanism. We're in the very throes of a new satanic age.
The Bible says that Satan is the god of this world, and he will blind the minds of unbelievers. Jesus called him the prince of this world and the father of lies. And the Bible continually warns us as Christians to be ready to stand against the wiles of the devil with words like, do not be deceived, be vigilant. That means awake, open your eyes, and be ready. Well, has Satan snuck in? Is there any deception within the church? Has he deceived you or me?
Despite what the Bible says about Satan being real, that he's a deceiver, that he's the god of this world who blinds minds, look at what's happened.
According to the Barna Research Group, in 2004, an incredible 50% of those who profess to be born again actually deny Satan's existence.
Do you understand what that's saying? Even though the Bible says that Satan is real, 50% of professing Christians deny that he even exists. And that's a very scary thing to do, because when you deny that Satan exists, you let your guard down, and that's when he can move in and bring deception to the church. It's kind of like denying that terrorists exist. You let your guard down if you don't believe in them, and then they can move in.
You may not be familiar with the story of the prodigal son. It's about a young man who went to his father and said, give me my inheritance. And he took his money, he went to a far country and spent it on riotous living. Jesus said further in the parable that it was upon prostitutes that he spent his money. A great famine came upon the land, his money ran out, his friends left him, and the only job he could get was feeding pigs. And as he sat in that pigsty, the Bible says he began to desire to eat the pig food. And as he looked at the pig food, suddenly he came to his senses and said, even my father's servants have it better than I. He said, I know what I'll do. I'll go back to my father and say, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. Make me a hired servant. So that's what he did. He got up out of the pigsty. He went back to his father. And the Bible tells us his father was actually looking for him, waiting for him. And when he saw him, he ran to him, fell upon him, kissed him. He called for a robe to cover his filth, a ring for his finger, and shoes for his feet. And he said, kill the fatted calf. We're going to have a feast. For once my son was dead, but now he's been made alive.
The story of the prodigal son is a picture of every person before they come to Christ. You and I had turned away from God to serve the devil and the pleasures of sin. The Bible actually says that there is a spirit that works in the children of disobedience. 1 John 3:8 says, he that commits sin is of the devil. And remember what Jesus said to the religious hypocrites of his day. He said that their father was the devil.
You are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it.
The Bible teaches us that unsaved people live in spiritual darkness. It's as simple as this. If you're serving sin, you're serving Satan.
You know, when we say, "Hail Satan," to a certain extent, I'm saying, "Hail me."
You see, our natural appetites are unclean. We desire pig food. And if you don't believe that, just think about what people crave. Think of what's in your average soap opera or primetime television show. It's filled with things like adultery, jealousy, lust, fornication, rape, gossip, greed. Or your popular movie today, with all of its violence, the filthy language, the explicit sex, and graphic murder. Look at the covers of magazines in bookstores and supermarkets, which a few years ago was considered softcore pornography and hidden from young people's eyes. Think of video games that kids crave. They're extremely violent and sexually perverted. Think of most rock music with its explicit sexuality, blasphemy, and its dark satanic side. Consider the internet's multi-billion dollar hardcore porn industry, or how the average person uses filthy words and blasphemy in everyday speech. Life in the pigsty is normal, natural, and completely acceptable.
Yes, Satan is the god of this world, and he has deceived millions, but the deception hasn't stopped there. It's moved into the church. Most people believe the devil is the darkest of figures, but the Bible tells us that he can reveal himself or present himself as an angel of light. Listen to what the Bible says about Satan's workers within the church.
For such men are false apostles, counterfeits, deceitful workmen, masquerading as apostles, special messengers of Christ. And it is no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. So it is not surprising if his servants also masquerade as ministers of righteousness.
Satan is incredibly subtle. The Bible says that he will even use professing men of God, ministers of righteousness, pastors, teachers, to deceive the church. Well, the most effective way for Satan to penetrate the church is at the point of entry, to poison the evangelistic message, to contaminate the gospel that brings people into the kingdom of God. And that's exactly what's happened. Satan has contaminated the biblical method of bringing people to Christ. And we've allowed ministers of righteousness, popular preachers and teachers, to move away from Scripture. They refuse to use the moral law, the Ten Commandments, to bring the knowledge of sin the way Jesus did, to show sin to be exceedingly sinful. And they do it in the name of being seeker-friendly, so they don't upset anyone and damage anyone's self-esteem. But remember what the Apostle Paul said, "I would not have known what sin was if it wasn't for the law." The law showed him that he was sinful and needed to repent. These preachers think they've found a shortcut to salvation. They leave out the law, the commandments. And in essence, what they're doing is they try to take the prodigal son back to the father without showing him that his appetites are unclean.
This is such an important point. Let's go through it again. Remember what it was that brought the prodigal to his senses, that made him go back to his father. It was when he looked at the food, the pig food, and realized that his appetites were unclean. He was desiring something that was filthy. That brought him to his senses and made him say, "Oh, even my father's servants have got it better than I do. I'll go back to my father and say, I've sinned against you. I've sinned against heaven. Make me your servant." In the name of sensitivity, modern preachers don't let that happen. They shortcut the process. Modern preachers have left out the law, and multitudes from pulpits to pews have never seen that their sins are exceedingly sinful in the sight of God. So they look on God as their servant. Instead of saying, "Make me your servant," they say to God, "Give me more."
Bill Bright, founder of Campus Crusade for Christ, said that less than 2% of Christians in America regularly share their faith with others. Instead, it seems that they would rather just look for what they can get from God: health, wealth, and prosperity. It seems that modern Christianity caters to selfishness. It's self-seeking, self-centered, and self-serving. Today's church has become the last day's Laodicean church that thinks it's rich and in need of nothing, when in reality, it's poor, blind, wretched, miserable, and naked.
James chapter 1 says, lay aside all filthiness. In other words, get up out of the pigsty and leave. And then scripture says, be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. A man who is in deception, according to scripture, is like a man who goes to a mirror, looks into the mirror, and then leaves and forgets what manner of man he is. And then the book of James tells us what the mirror is into which we should be looking. It is the perfect law of God. God's law has the ability to show us if we're in deception. Let me give you an example. Do you, as a professing Christian, always keep your word? Or do you tell little lies? Do you take little things that belong to other people? Or perhaps you don't give God's name its due reverence and say, oh my G-O-D. Or perhaps you have a wandering eye when it comes to the opposite sex, both in entertainment and in real life. Well, on the day of judgment, when you face that perfect law, it will find you to be a lying, thieving, blasphemous adulterate heart. And the one you call Lord will say to you, depart from me, you worker of lawlessness. I never knew you. If that is you, then you're in deception. Wake up. Get up out of the pigsty. Flee to the foot of a bloodstained cross and cry, Father, I have sinned against heaven. Make me your servant. And then do the will of God from the heart and seek and save that which is lost. After the apostle Paul was converted on the road to Damascus, listen to what Jesus said to him.
But rise, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins.
If you know the same Jesus, you have the same commission to open the eyes of sinners, to bring them out of darkness into light, from the power of Satan to the power of God, that they might receive forgiveness of sins. And the way to do that is to do what Paul did, to do what Jesus did, to use the Ten Commandments to bring the knowledge of sin, to use the moral law to show them they need God's forgiveness.
How do you learn how to do that? Go to our website at wayofthemaster.com. And get a copy of the Evidence Bible. It has answers to the 100 most commonly asked questions and objections to the Christian faith. You could join the School of Biblical Evangelism on the website. And don't forget about the Foundation course. It's an 8-week course designed for your Bible study group or your personal study to teach you how to share the gospel biblically.
And there's tapes people can listen to freely online.
And you can watch these episodes freely online. Don't forget to sign up for our free email newsletter. God bless you as you seek and save the lost.
Do you think Satan has any influence over rock music?
No, not over rock music, over the individuals producing the certain rock music. If you're a weak-minded person, Satan will corrupt your mind into saying Satan's good and Satan's that. Therefore, the young kids go out and buy the music.
Satan.
Yeah, the Satan music, and then they think Satan, Satan, Satan.
You said Satan corrupts weak-minded people.
Yeah.
Do you think he's corrupted you?
No, sir.
Have you ever lied?
Yes, everybody has lied, though.
So he's corrupted you there, yeah. Have you ever stolen something?
Yeah, when I was like 8, 9, 10, I would steal toys.
Have you ever used God's name in vain?
Everybody has, yes.
So he's corrupted you there?
Yes.
And Jesus said if you look with lust, you commit adultery in your heart.
I don't know that.
Have you ever looked at a woman with lust?
Many people have, and I am guilty of that also.
So he's corrupted you there?
Yes.
So Satan's corrupted you. He's blinded your mind.
And you music know, doesn't cause
but,
that,
babe,
though.
I could handle my own. Yeah, but I'm not going to... I will not say, I love you, Satan. Thank you, Satan. Here's what I say. F*** you, Satan. I believe
but
in God, man.
You're serving him. You're serving him. As long as you're sinning, you're serving Satan. That's what the Bible teaches.
But I go to church, though. When I get Sundays off, I try to go to church. My
well,
heart is...
If God judges you...
When I pass in front of a church, I pray to him. And you know what I mean?
So if God judges you by the Ten Commandments on the Day of Judgment, are you going to be innocent or guilty? Bearing in mind that you've admitted you're a liar, a thief, a blasphemer, and an adulterer at heart.
I have not taken another soul, another living life, and I will repent for my sins. I repent for my sins fairly
often. Do you know
often.
That won't help you on Judgment Day?
That depends if you're Catholic or Christian.
Well, no one can be saved through repenting of their
this
sins.
This is my brother Jerry right here.
Hey, Jerry, we'll be with you in a minute if you want
I'm
to be interviewed.
I'm Spider.
That's
oh,
really
Spider.
Good.
I mean, Spider.
Hey, Mike.
But Satan.
We're talking about something real important, Jerry.
Satan hasn't corrupted
Eric,
me.
God bless all
I
of you.
I can prove it that he hasn't corrupted me.
Well, the Bible says he blinds the minds of those that believe not, that he deceives the nations.
That's where
so
I.
So listen to this. Listen to this.
Slayer.
I dig a hole for myself because I'm not as educated as I should be on the Bible matters. Like I don't read out of the Bible and stuff like that. I should read out of the Bible. You know what I mean? You people are similar, and I don't mean to put any of you down, are similar to my grandma.
I like your grandma.
My grandma hears this. She's like, mijo, what is this? Mijo, why do you hear this? It's Satan and all that kind of stuff like that. You know what I mean? That's how my grandma thinks. And no, grandma, it's not like that. I pray to God at night. I tell him, thank you, God, for giving me a job. Thank you, God, for giving me this beautiful wife. And I thank God and I pray to God. And I really dislike Satan. I'm not going to use the word hate because that's a very strong word.
I'm trying to tell you something very important. You can say you're sorry to God all your life, and God will not forgive you just because you're sorry. That's Mike, that's like saying to a judge, I've broken the law. I've committed a serious crime, but I'm sorry. He's not going to let you go because you're bound by the law. He must punish you. And God says, if you've sinned, you should be sorry because you've got a conscience, you've done wrong. But telling God you're sorry won't mean you're forgiven. If you listen to this, let me finish because this is really important. If you die in your sins and God gives you justice, you'll end up in hell.
Oh, man. Why is God going to do that to me?
Because he's going to give you what you deserve.
I worship him as often as I could when I get the chance.
Yeah, but listen to this.
I go to church.
Listen to this. You cannot be saved by doing anything. The only thing you can do is do what the Bible says. And this is how God can forgive you. Jesus suffered and died on the cross. He took your punishment upon his own body.
Thank you.
Okay? So what you've got to do is repent and trust in him.
This episode of Wave the Master has inspired you to share the message of eternal life. You can watch our award-winning movies, such as The Atheist Delusion, freely on our website, where you'll also find articles, videos, and audio messages, as well as books, DVDs, gospel tracts, and other resources to help you share your faith biblically and effectively. Make sure to visit livingwaters.com today.